Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Indie 3. We had a little bit of miscommunication on time zones. We just had some time zone snafus, and so we've been all day jumping back and forth between whether this panel's at 5 p.m. or at 8 p.m. or at 5 p.m., and now we are set. That is happening right now. Critical Approaches with Austin Howe and James Howell. And so we're going to bring them in, and they're going to talk about the different ways that we approach games and game culture in a critical way. A huge treat and a great honor to host them both.
I will go ahead and bring them in.
Awesome. Hello, Austin, James.
Hello.
Hello.
It's a great honor to host you guys, and I will give you guys the floor to introduce yourselves and what you guys will be talking about today.
Hey, don't forget to get Zolani.
Oh, yes. Zolani is currently talking in the Indy 4, the panel going on in Indy 4, so we're just going to have to...
Oh, they're still going? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yep. So, we'll grab him soon, too.
Okay, James, I'll let you go first.
Well, thank you. Well, my name is James Clinton Howell. In terms of video game critical stuff, I'm author of Driving Off the Map, Structural Analysis of Metal Gear Solid 2, and Monstrous Births, Structural Analysis of Metal Gear Solid 4. Other background, I've written a lot about Metal Gear for PlayStation Official Magazine, provided additional localization support on MGS4, as well as Metal Gear Solid 2 digital graphic novel, and that's my CV, except I got a master's degree in poetry. Yep. So, there you go.
My name's Austin Howe. I mostly write for Haptic Feedback, my blog spot about video games and occasionally music, and I'm a huge fan of James.
Thank you.
So, our panel today, I was talking to James the other day, and we were setting up a few things, and I was talking to James about how unique his perspectives are on games, since he comes from a lot of different backgrounds that are kind of unusual for games critics to be coming from. And so I decided to throw together a panel with myself, him, and Zolani Stewart, who will be joining us shortly, just to talk about how different fields unrelated to games criticism have helped us approach this field of games criticism, which is very young and developing. And so we're taking lots of notes from other fields, both in terms of just like critical, like philosophy, critical theory, any other sort of stuff. So, James, I thought I'd just let you have the floor for a minute if you wanted to, unless you wanted me to just ask you questions or that sort of thing.
Oh, well, excuse me, one second.
It's okay.
Coughing live. Yeah, I just wanted to, I guess, in terms of my own background, the types of studies and research that I do are primarily linguistic, historical linguistics, to be precise. I don't really know any other. I don't know any language that anybody else speaks besides English. The other ones are all dead Germanics. And theology and poetry are the three fields that I have the most extensive knowledge in. And sort of my approach is to studying, retaining, and doing anything productive with those fields within their contexts. There's always a bleed over into any kind of other critical study that you do. So I think so. Those are the ones that I bring to the table that others might not.
Hi everyone. I just finished the last panel just before, so I just got in here. I hope I didn't miss too much,
we were just finishing introductions.
Okay. Oh, really? Okay. Okay, yeah. Hi, James. How are you doing? My name is Lonnie Stewart, if anyone doesn't know. I'm a critic. I write and talk about games. I stream with Austin sometimes. And yeah, that's basically a lot of it. And I do some Let's Plays as well, so that's basically what I do. I'm not sure what everyone was at right now, but...
James was talking a little bit about linguistics, and I think I was just going to go right into asking him about... So you read lots of poetry, you have a master's degree in poetry, and And I thought that was interesting because I noted when we were talking on Skype about how a lot of what I have learned about poetry, the very minimal of it, has been that a lot of times people will tell you to look at structure in a poem to tell you to see like what the, you know, to investigate meaning in the poem. And I found that interesting because a lot of your most of the work of yours that I'm familiar with, the Metal Gear Solid 2 essay and the Metal Gear Solid 4 essay, which we'll be having another panel about in an hour. And as well as the Rootwork building, which is ongoing, are all structural critiques.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, that's right. I totally forgot about the Rootwork build. The Rootwork building, a title I chose specifically for its clunkiness and proving its value right there. Anyway, yeah, yeah. And the Rootwork building, incidentally, is about structural analysis of how The Last of Us, Naughty Dog's The Last of Us, self-cannibalizes is always a little more of a down term than I would like to use, but self-reference is sort of a little too cold and academic also. I haven't quite found the middle ground, but the general idea is that, you know, it uses its own materials to revise and represent, as well as represent how its contents, how its story is unfolding in ways that I think you perceive on a level. I mean, if you're really into it, and this is one of the things about structure in terms of poetry that is often sort of not appreciated well, because poetry is not very well taught in a lot of cases, because you kind of think structure, okay, iambic pentameter. No. I hate iambic pentameter, you know.
I keep saying that in English class over and over again. I keep forgetting it the next semester. I don't know, honestly.
It's true. I get that. That's but the thing is, it's like structure is something that, you know, you're sort of trained. It's the way that we sort of negotiate and comprehend things. To sort of take a little bit of content from the opening of the Rootwork building, I think there are certain structures that we are more culturally conversant with, that we use more frequently in the more popular media. So whereas something like iambic pentameter summons up, you know, maybe some memories of forced appreciation of you know, like Shakespeare or whatever. You know, the five act structure, the five act narrative structure, is something that everybody is more or less conversant with and uses casually and without any grudge, because, you know, you go into a movie, you talk about the climax of the movie, and you're using that, and, you know, and then the resolution and the build up and all this other stuff. You know, all that structural language, and there are just some structures that we use that are more current and that are more fluid for us. And with respect to video games, the structures are varied, and typically each game, I think, requires particular assessment. And
we don't have something as universal as five act in video games yet. I mean, some games may attempt to have a five act narrative, but in terms of the structure of how a game is played and such, we don't have something nearly as universal in how games are played, except for challenge escalation, maybe as an idea in terms of design. I agree with that. I wanted to focus on that. Go ahead. Yeah, sorry.
No, I think that's actually a really good point. And that's the thing where I think a lot of structural analysis of a game should come from challenge not just challenge escalation, but how interaction is initiated and the way that interactivity develops up to the end of either the end of the player's experience, which is distinct from the end of the game experience, because sometimes, you know, sometimes there are some games where you quit before there's an end because there is no end, like Tetris, you know.
Right.
I actually think that that's really very exciting. I critically and intellectually, I mean, because the more dominant a particular kind of structure is, the more you are, the more as a creative person, the more likely you are to use it, because, well, you don't have to really work that hard to get people to understand a five act structure. Whereas with something like experimental theater, you know, you have to be able to you have to be able to manipulate unknown, understood structures in such a way to make your work intelligible. So we don't have that many fixed. We have some fixed patterns in video games, and many of them are in terms of traditional challenge escalation. I think like on the RPG, I think would be a pretty good example. Numbers go up. That's a structure.
But many of them are largely coincidental to their own games. Like, for example, what Last of Us does with, like, for example, the characters, like, what was it? Like, using planks to get across things, like the use of puzzles, like, and those really, like, set puzzle designs as like a communication, as like a communication of like the emotional state or like the where the relationship between those characters is at. Like you pointed out how the first time Ellie is in gameplay, you don't lift her up on a ledge, but Tess does. And then later, as you come to trust her, you repeat that thing that you did with Tess with Ellie to demonstrate that you and Ellie have that the main character and Ellie have that same trust between each other. And that's largely, like, maybe there are similar examples in other games, but, like, that's like, fairly unique to The Last of Us.
So...
Yeah. Oh, sorry, go on, please.
Oh, well, because I'm just listening, and what's it called? This question of structure is interesting to me, and like, it's hard, and it's hard for me to it's hard for me two things. One is it's hard for me to wonder whether this is actually like particular, like how I should interpret this. Like, is this a bad thing or not? But it's hard for me to see it as that. I feel like when I think about you know, so sometimes I feel like to try to ask what is unique about video games always feels like a very sort of like a hopeless question. In a sense, it feels like whenever I try to do this as someone who you know likes to do my own study on other arts, I see so many similarities that when I think about the uniqueness of games, I always feel like I started at that end. But there's this question of experience. This question of experience, which I mean, it seems to imply to me this sort of an almost like an infinite sort of variability, right? That makes structure hard. That makes the idea of approaching something of, well, here's a structure of how a game works, a lot more difficult. What we do know in video games particularly is that I don't use this, and Austin knows very well that I'm not a huge into it, but what is commonly understood in video games is the understanding that you have a story and you have a gameplay, right? Is that there are these two particular parts in the gameplay scene?
Yeah,
is
two
sort
separate
of
things.
Yeah, these two separate things. Gameplay is like the sort of bubble assemblage term of, okay, well, this has something to do with sort of input and response that I do with the game. The story seems to be the areas of things in which you know, expositional parts of it, because a lot of big games, a lot of console games are very I'm going to use a term for people in China, I'm going to use diegetic, right, in the sense that it's people talking, people say words, there's dialogue, that kind of thing, right?
And as they say, the primary, okay, method of narrative.
As a primary method of narrative, right? So it's a prosaic thing. It's like, okay, well, here are the words people saying to me, right? And then we will think of gameplay as, okay, well, here's the stuff that I'm doing when I move the controller around and do stuff like that. And I guess, and it's not the best thing, but I feel like that's a lot of, it's just weird because I never really found this sufficient as a person who writes about games, and I was never really into it. Or at least recently, I don't use it or think it's too useful. But the thing about it is that what I realize is that perhaps it's not particularly useful because of the way games are, because maybe it's the idea that the games seem to resist the kind of sort of structureless kind of conceptualizing of, okay, well, you know, you have these acts here. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They go kind of like this, and I could teach this in a class, and everyone's going to know it. But there isn't really much like that. And the 5-hour structure is something that is also in itself not too sufficient, right? Because it is meant for a very specific type of literature. Same thing for the story gameplay is very, very particular type of game. And when we go to different kinds of games, something that the structure kind of breaks down. And we think, okay, well, maybe we need new structures to think about. Or maybe we shouldn't have structures at all.
So
and that's like a weird thing to think about and wonder, like what is useful to for conceptualizing games as the thing and what isn't. But
well, I think maybe part of what you're saying is that games, they kind of resist a lot of our attempts to throw structures onto them that existed in other forms of media, because they, like, not obviously as an active thing, like they're a sentient form or something, but like but the thing is that our attempts to use just what we know from other mediums and to put them into games have been a little bit dysfunctional, because Well, simply because games are a different medium and they speak through a different language than necessarily, you know, like plays and film can speak through 5-act structure or whatever, and novels are often completely fine doing away with that as well. But they don't, what was I going to say? Sometimes they just need different stuff. I completely lost the end of that sentence.
I can take over if you want, because I do have some particular thoughts on that. I'll take over. What? You was saying something?
I said no. Go for it.
Okay. Yeah. Totally. So then I'll send him back when he remembers. I just one of the things I know is because I know that James, from what I caught from what you're saying, is that you're someone who's very well versed in literature, specifically. I know that Austin invited me to talk on the panel particularly because he knew that I was someone who likes to study visual arts a lot. I read a lot of abstract criticism on abstract art. I read a lot of visual arts criticism. I do some sculpture, abstract culture writing as well on sculpture and stuff like that. So visual arts generally. And when I read about abstract art, I realize that it's very, very close. I read about abstract art and I sit there and think, wow, this reminds me of a video game. And I think, wow, like this, I feel like there's something here that reminds me. He's reminding me of games for some reason. And when you're sitting there thinking, well, you know, because also I'm saying, well, it seems like games seem to resist a lot of structures, right? They seem to resist things that we use to conceptualize other forms. But then when I'm reading about abstract and visual arts, for some reason, I play games and I think, actually, you know, the context that I can bring into this from visual arts is actually incredibly useful. If I can
well,
actually
this is
make
not to say that other fields' understandings of their own fields are not useful for games.
Oh, of course
obviously.
Not. No, of course not. Yeah.
Gives me a good question. Is you started to realize that using like these ideas from abstract art criticism and using them on games, you found it to be a particularly helpful lens. James, when you were writing any of the things that you've written about, you know, structural criticisms, MGS2, MGS4, Last of Us, did you have a conscious realization that you are pulling these things from poetry or even from theology, if we want to go there? That's basically the end of my question. Did you actually like consciously realize this, or was it kind of unconscious thing for you?
But before I answer that, I actually want to piggyback on something that Zalani was talking about just a second ago, which is that if I remember correctly, I believe that the creator of the original Katamari Damacy came from a background of sculpture, and he became frustrated with it. Like it wasn't satisfying him, so he wound up getting into game design. But it's really interesting because you can look at that, and it's about physical orientation and spatial relationships, and figuring out how to negotiate a new spatial relationship that you are to the rest of the environment, and gathering things up, and you know, weight and gravity, and all this other stuff that is sort of implied in collecting things onto your little katamari. So on a creative end, I think that it's important. For the liveliness, I guess. I'm not finding the right word for it, but to keep it fresh, to have people from a variety of different disciplines and backgrounds coming in as creators, I think that's. I think Katamari Damacy is maybe one of the best examples I can think of that.
I just looked it up, and it doesn't say anything about him being a sculptor, but his Wikipedia article does list him. As like he cites several like painters and sculptors as influences.
Interesting. Okay. But to answer your question, Austin, when I wrote the MGS2 essay back in 2004, I think it's been 10 years.
Really? I could have sworn it was marked for 2007 when I last read it.
I don't. Remember? No.
I can go look it up.
It's later than that, but I was aware that a lot of basically my an old professor of mine who I consider like you know my first sort of mentor who passed away within the past few years, a guy named Steve Gardner. One of the things about poetic structure that he taught me, one of the first things I learned was that in terms of rhythm. And if you're going to go the way of rhyme, in terms of just basically the structure that you present your reader in the first 10 lines of a poem is a contract. That is a contract that you will continue to use that structure throughout, in order to give the thing, in order simply to give the thing shape, coherent shape, and any divergence from that structure is has to be meaningful if you're going to be artful about the execution of the other structure of your poem. So, you know, I believe that there are some examples of T.S. Eliot that are the specific poems are dropping from mine, but structure in T.S. Eliot is like that's a huge part of his work, and so basically creating that contract and then breaking it. When you break it, that means something, and then you can look to kind of like that's the structural change, and then you look at kind of what you and Zalani were talking about in terms of the diegetic quality of the poem, which is kind of a misplaced use of that term, but to connect that the content of the poem. So then I say, okay, structure changed. Let me look at content. The words does this change in structure now mean that he's being ironic, or does this mean that we are now in a different headspace, or you know what does this indicate? So that quality, that particular approach to poetry, that which is where I started at and where I sort of have built my foundations upon, it certainly was in my mind with Metal Gear Solid 2, with driving off the map. With the MGS4 essay, it was a little bit different because the focus of that structure is not as self-contained as MGS2. It's MGS2 creates a structure in itself and then breaks it, whereas MGS4 is more like Metal Gear Solids 1, 2, and 3 have created the structure. Now let's crash it. So
right, that's, yeah. Let's so, defragment it.
Yeah, exactly. And so that's in terms of being self-aware of that I was, you know, sort of importing some a way of looking at it. I was aware of that, but I wasn't consciously thinking like I'm going to interpret this video game as a poem. You know. So, does that answer kind of what you're asking?
Yeah, no, that actually offers a lot of insight about the essay for me as well, because it's like you know, that idea that, you know, the first 10 lines establish something and that when you change it, it has to mean something. I mean, obviously MGS2 is probably like the least subtle example of this that has ever been made, but it's literally like, you know, it's like, hey guys, here's MGS1. Say goodbye to MGS1.
Yeah, exactly.
The map crinkled in our hands and we drove off the cliff. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's, and in terms of, in terms of critical approach, for me, I find that critical articulation is equivalent in importance to critical analysis, and this is where this is where I would say that both poetry and theology do converge in terms of method, which is that for both of those essays, they're right in the titles, they're image based. And the idea is to, I mean, it's in terms of my approach, this is, I don't attribute this to anything that should be universal about criticism, but I regard it perhaps as more idiosyncratic, is I see criticism as sort of an imprint, like, you know, like you had like Silly Putty and you stick it down on a newspaper and you rip it up and you kind of have this, you have a mirror form of it on the putty in your hand. Criticism is this sort of like, is like it's the video game lifted just a few inches up above itself. You're talking about this video game, and the way that you talk about it needs to be self-consistent. Ideally, you know, whatever approach you take should be so self-consistent that it can accommodate for any other question about content that arises that you perhaps don't even address in the course of your writing about it. So
is this in part why you had at the beginning of Driving Off the Map the list of terms that you use explaining things like actor and such, you know, explaining that like these terms mean exactly the same thing every time I use them and there's no variation?
Yeah, that's exactly why that's exactly the approach I take, because Again, to quote old Steve Gardner, ambiguity executed well is art. Ambivalence is bad communication. So
yep.
I wanted to avoid ambivalence, which is spend, take a set space aside, kind of like put you in the warm up circle. And I haven't played baseball since Little League. I probably shouldn't even use that image. Anyway, give you the specific space where it's like, okay, this is what this means. This is what this means. Let's go. And so
right.
That helps it to that goes a long way toward internal self-consistency, and that in turn can lead to a stronger thesis or a stronger critical approach. And that's the way I handle that.
And speaking just in terms of raw essay structure or whatever, it kind of helps, well, it basically does what you said, where it warms your audience up to be in this self-contained space of I was going to end up saying some variation on what you said, which is basically just that it helps, it helps the audience become, ready to engage with this work as the main intellectual activity they're going to be doing for however long it takes to read the essay,
Right. And hopefully... Oh, no, I'm sorry. Go on.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to add as a tail on that, that hopefully, what work you accomplish over the course of the critical essay can then be used as a way of better appreciating both the game upon replay, but also, if the terms are strong enough, they can be used to help provisionally articulate the experience of playing another game, but that could be completely unrelated.
When I was writing my essay about MGS1, I almost ended up using the exact same terminology. I was literally just going to borrow the terms paper from word for word and be like, I'm using exactly this terminology. But then again, that's kind of because, it helps a lot that MGS1 and MGS2 are so similar in those ways, but that's a discussion for the next panel. But what was I going to say? So yeah, also I wanted to ask about theology a little bit and wonder if there was anything in particular about theology that also influenced either what kind of games you like to write about, how you approach it, or what kind of topics in games you tend to approach.
Well, that's a little more difficult of a direct connection to make, because poetry, of course, being art and being expression of a specific of a particular kind, it is easier to find analogs between that and another expression of a particular kind, which is video games. Whereas theology is both argument and both argument. Definition and consistency, and those are the main qualities that I think I would say that my study of theology both largely I tend to study systematic theology, which going all the way back to just for clarification, I'm Presbyterian for context, going all the way back to an early church patriarch like Origen, who was the first person to write a comprehensive expression of this is how everything that we are talking about believing in, this is how everything relates to everything else. And my current preferred theologian, guy named Paul Tillich, is another guy who does systematic theology. And the idea is that every part of your system points to every other part. It's all self-affirming. It's like a circle. It's like no part relies on anything else other than, or rather, an arch, as I say. Well, no, even the arch is not a good example. Anyway, every part relies upon every other part for the whole thing to maintain its structure, and within that balanced self-sustenance, there is articulation through symbolic imagery, and that's kind of like the process of theology, and that very much connects with the way that I try to approach criticism, which is sort of going back to that silly putty illustration where what you're writing about is what you are writing is not the game, and you understand that. Just like in theology, what you are writing is not your topic. You're writing about your topic. You are not writing your topic, and so that's a distinction that I take from that. And in terms of specific,
So maybe a horribly simplified version of that would be that theology aims to be, the kind of theology you like to read, at least, aims to be completely self-consistent. And so that kind of influences at least something that you strive for in your criticism, which is that your criticism of a game is like structurally self-consistent, that no element of your criticism is in contradiction to one another.
Right.
Sort of.
No, yeah, that is a good sum up of it, and that each part of the essay makes sense because it's in the context of every other part of the essay, there's a sort of starting idea that I have that, you know, the player in the game, and this can be applied beyond video games, but the player in the game there's a degree of estrangement there, which is particularly apt given Metal Gear Solid 2 and its themes. But there's a degree of estrangement there, and the critical process is a way of overcoming that estrangement, overcoming that distance, and that as well is a sort of methodological concern of theology that I bring into that. So, yeah.
Hey, is Lonnie? You in here?
I didn't. Yep, I'm still here. It's just that you were never kind of going back and forth.
I was wondering if you had anything to go on there.
I do actually have a few things there. That is a very, very, very structural approach. Like one that's very focused on devices and like having terms and then like using particular terms consistently. I feel like my own criticism has sort of distanced itself from that kind of thing for a while. You were talking before about how this idea of you know, if I do criticism, if I write about a game, what I'm writing about is the game, which is an interesting idea for a few reasons. One of them is because sometimes when I feel like when I'm writing about a video game, I feel like I'm sitting there and I'm like, is this really particularly the experience that it is? Because I'll sit there and I'll describe what it feels like to play a game. Right. If I learn anything from actually reading arts criticism, it's this understanding of description, right? Which is the idea that I'm saying, well, what is this? What is happening in front of me? What do I see? What is going on, or at least what Austin likes is what is a game doing? What do I see that it's doing, and how can I describe that in the way that's actually as clear as possible? And in that sense, you could say that I actually am sort of reproducing the game. That when I talk about a game, what I'm talking about is actually the game. Because I'm literally in some senses actually describing it. I'm describing it in a way that's a little different. Maybe I'm being a little more romantic about it. I should, right? I wrote a piece of Waver 64, and I was a little bit romantic about, you know, how what it feels like to go on the waves and such like that. So in a sense, there's this idea that some of it is actually partly poetic, in that sense, the way that you can describe a game. And in that sense, perhaps you can even argue that it's actually sometimes inconsistent. With the way that you can actually describe a game and talk about a game, because if we go back to this really weird sort of like annoying, you know, idea of experience in a sense, then I want to be able to make as much space as possible for inconsistency. If we're gonna do structural stuff, then I'm gonna put down the post structural card, and I'm gonna be like there should be some kind of space for things that aren't consistent. Like a space for if I interpret something and maybe two things actually seem contradictory, because games and all works are contradictory in some sense, right? There are things this idea that when we play games or if we approach any, you know, particular kind of work, we find out that they actually fall apart. And this is the difference between people who approach things in a quote unquote the structural sense and philosophers like Derrida or Derrida and you know Barthes after like a little while, particularly how they say, okay, actually what they wanted to do, right? This is what they call the French post-structuralists. So they said, okay, well these texts, these poems, you know, these films actually don't make any sense at all. They actually need to be deconstructed. They need to have the whole found in them and realize, okay, well this actually doesn't really work. Right, the way that we think it works, right, and this is the understanding of you know reading the text against itself, right, which is an idea that's said a lot there, and I guess my work, I guess I kind of go back and forth between the two, in that particular sense. I think only once I've written a piece where I felt like I needed to put the terms down and go into it, and that was, and I'm pretty sure that was a very design heavy piece. It was a very piece that was into like, okay, well, what are the responses here? What are the structures here? And I need to go down to analysis of it. But when it comes to let me describe an experience, which is the idea again, why I'm interested, why I find it so fun just to read about paintings. You know, it's this idea of, you know, this thing of like, well, what does it feel like to look at this? Right, and I sit there and I look at like a painting or something, and I sit there and I say, okay, well, you know, the it's like it's incredibly like what's it called? It's incredibly intimidating. It's really chilly the way that these things start to move together and such like that. So this idea of describing what an experience is something that I think goes a little further than consistency. I think it actually goes into weird inconsistency. This idea of what does it feel like to engage with something? What does it feel like to play a game? And how can I articulate that in a way that takes into account the very messy idea of the geez, like I guess of like of sort of an experience of engaging with something, if that makes any sense at all.
No, yeah, that thing makes sense.
Okay, yeah. That's one I wanted to know particularly.
No,
I'm
sorry,
grasping at a thought here, so James, if you have something to say, go ahead, because I need to clarify this thing in my head.
totally. Oh no, I was going to. I just wanted to respond to when you were mentioning like the sort of a post-structuralist approach and deconstructing, where you read. I think the phrase was "read the text against itself." I think that is a different kind of writing than I do sort of most reflexively, but it's solid work. I mean, when it's, I mean, of course, and it's true of anything when it has to be done well, but that the inconsistencies and the contradictions of experience, I don't know if like my like okay, taking that idea, my impulse would be to correlate those to each other in a way that, even if they're contradictory, doesn't
It makes
set
something
one
in you.
against the. I'm not trying to set one against the other, but trying to just sort of say, well, I have this, and then I have what appears to be a polar opposite expression, experience, or sensation of another sort, and reconciling those two by, I guess, like putting them in conversation with each other is, in terms of critical approach, I mean, that's how I would handle that. But
I would like to note, going off of that, that this is where some of my bother with the term ludonarrative dissonance is starting to come from, because as much as I value that idea that, you know, these two elements don't work against each other, I think there are already plenty of examples of games that are using intentional dissonance to create a kind of to create both a tone and also to communicate an idea, which is something that Zelani, go ahead.
Well, it's just like, well, yeah. I mean, I'm pretty sure we talked about that before. But I mean, like, to be honest, like at a certain point, I stopped finding that term useful. You know what I mean? And again, one of the things I always felt is that the way that we approach games, the way that we conceptualize games, is always centers a very particular style of game, which is like the sort of like traditional kind of like 10-hour console game. And because of that, and I think that's where the little narrow dissonance arise, which is that we start to realize that there's a difference between a game that you know wants to sort of replicate these kinds of very sort of hierarchical, very progressive kind of structures where, you know, I go through levels, I collect these particular things, I always have a win and a lose state, right? These kinds of things, right? And ludonarrative dissonance was this thing that seemed to resolve the kinds of weird conflicts that sort of arisen from that. But there are games that don't have the structures at all. And then when you and when we start to play those games, we have to realize that this idea isn't like I guess as I go on, I feel like that idea wasn't as needed as I thought it was. And I feel like that term wasn't as necessary as I used to think it was as I gone on. And I feel like I feel like I've developed better ways of explaining what that what that sort of dissonance is. And I think I've done that particularly by talking about something in an ideological sense, right? Brennan Keogh recently wrote a piece in The Conversation, which is, I'm pretty sure, is some kind of Australian website, and he wrote about themes, capital T themes, right? T themes TM, right? It's this sort of
hashtag
jokey.
Themes.
Hashtag themes. So it's sort of this sort of jokey term, this idea that you get a lot of AAA games these days that really want to sort of show that they're online with politics, but then when you play them, they don't seem to be online with politics at all. It's an understanding of a game that seems to have a sort of facade that it's interested in the most relevant political discussion. Well, then you play it's totally off, right? Here's a game about Occupy Wall Street or something, but I'm just going through shooting stuff and collecting things and getting achievements like normal. Right.
Yes.
So it's this idea like this is the idea Lunar Distance was supposed to solve, right? But we realize that this is like a weird term. What's usually better is actually discussing what are sort of political sort of conflicts that are going on here, particularly, which is the idea that I want a game that wants to, you know, give me the sense of, or perhaps perhaps bluntly, give me the illusion of being engaged in politics, but I don't want to actually engage with politics. Because engagement with politics means actually engaging politics on a level of play, on the level of going response. That means I'm not going to be sitting there shooting dudes for 10 hours, right? And I think and at least that's my opinion, particularly on that kind of on that kind of split.
Well, I'll also note that briefly after its inception, ludonarrative dissonance became the most overused term in the history of the English language. But
did it? I feel like I missed that part. I feel like I came right after that.
Yeah,
I
kind of feel the same thing. I feel the same way. Like I kind of like popped my head up one day and looked around, and there was this term, ludonarrative dissonance. Like, that sounds pretty rad.
I'll try not to like derail it too much, but I mean, I do like mean to highlight this every time. Is that the Clint Hawking essay about BioShock, ludonarrative dissonance in BioShock from 2007? It defines ludonarrative dissonance specifically as the themes of the gameplay, or rather the themes of the narrative, contradicting what we might call the themes of the gameplay. And he cited this as BioShock has a narrative theme that essentially supports altruism and decries selfishness, while it has gameplay that exclusively rewards selfishness. And even presents altruism as only a pathway to later self gains. And so that was like a specific thing. And the thing about it is that, like, as it went on or whatever, it's literally just people saying, like, well, the comical tone of this violence doesn't really match the serious tone of that story. And I'm just like, no, that's just a bad game. that's not dissonant, it's just bad.
That's a bigger problem thing. But again, what's it called? And this is why I feel like I keep having this conflict in my head between I want to approach things in a really rigid structural way, and I want to actually try to approach this as this fluid entity. I want to approach a game as a fluid entity, and I want to keep and it's weird to it's interesting to keep switching between these, right? It's like a weird thing to do, and it's hard to try to figure that out, right? But I feel like when it comes to I mean I know you don't want to spend too much on the term, but what I will say quickly is that I feel like that does come from. Because like one of the things that it assumes that the idea of narrative and a game are two separate things, right? When they're not, right? If there's a but the is that it has to assume that for the term to actually make sense, right? And this idea that the fact that people would think that there's a very hard split in this, not only assumes a particular kind of game, like I said before, right? But I mean, it's also what's it called? I totally just lost my train of thought. I just had something, but I totally lost it.
Well, I can
go ahead
if I jump off that wall.
You should fill in while I remember what I was just about to say. Jeez.
Okay, yeah. As soon as you remember, interrupt me. Don't worry. It's on that point, as I said before, I really did just pop my head up one day, and there's this term ludonarrative dissonance that was kind of hopping around, and I saw it. I saw it directed toward The Last of Us as a game where it's like, the story is doing, and then the particular ways and kinds of violence that there was a conflict. Somebody was anticipating a conflict on the level of Drake's Fortune, which is really weird because I think really The Last of Us is sort of like a design. The Last of Us is sort of like a design response to the problem of whatever ludonarrative dissonance you might find in something
like
Uncharted, because
the tone of the violence in Last of Us is incredibly somber and dry.
Yes. Yes. No. It's like it basically takes the Jeez. It takes the overused, "We're not so different, you and I," element at the, like at the end of Uncharted 2, and even at the end of like Revengeance, where Raiden has Armstrong's artificial nanomachine heart, kum 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 kum, in his hand. Anyway, anybody who hasn't played Revengeance, none of what I said was true. No spoilers. Anyway, but so basically, it's kind of like I was kind of frustrated when I was reading those kinds of responses to it, and that's really where like kind of the root work building came from, because I'm like, no, this game has a structure, and this is what it is, and this is how I would articulate it. And I mean, it's like there are some, and there are even some elements of representation and player action that are dissonant, such as when, you know, I actually think that during the tutorial sequence of The Last of Us, when you hop down into this sort of like bandits tunnel, and you get your firearm, and the tutorial intends to show you how to reload, and it's like, I think in the cutscene like right before that, Joel, who's your main character, is actually examining the number of bullets in his the magazine he's about to put in there, and he puts it in there, and then it tells you to reload, and it's like, basically it's like, you know, you pick up like two or three bullets at a time, and if you are actually reloading an actual gun, like you would actually have to drop the magazine out, put those bullets in that magazine, and then put it back in. Yeah, but it's like nobody cares about that, because like I mean if you could make an interesting game around that idea, but that's not sort of like to the purposes that The Last of Us seems to be trying to sort of reach. And so it's kind of like, that's the sort of thing where he's kind of like, oh yeah, video game, it's fictional. So, you know, it's a degree of realism that is dropped for the sake of expedience, so that the play experience can be more seamless. Whereas there are other elements of realism that are highlighted and even intensified along the, I know that some people have kind of called like The Last of Us kind of like a Cormac McCarthy video game, because of the severe quality of some of the violence. And really, it's like the violence that is most, that's emphasized and is given the almost hyperbolic qualities is the close personal stuff, where, you know, you are actually wailing on people with boards and pipes and bricks. And it's at that point where you encounter even, you know, your enemies groveling on the ground before you, like, please, please don't kill me. And it's really interesting, because as callous as Joel as a character is supposed to be, when you get to that point and they're like groveling in front of you, like, he actually, if you try to continue using the attack that you were using on them, he actually won't respond. So it's kind of like the game's controls sort of like fall flat to, like, his conscience essentially overrides your input, but you can override that by switching weapons.
That's always been an interesting concept to me, that I want to see more of in games, and it was something that first really occurred to me after I read the MGS2 essay, is that this idea that the idea that's kind of at the core of the Metal Gear series, which is that the player and the player character are not the same person, you know, like they're kind of a symbiotic entity, but they are definitely two distinct individuals, if that makes sense. And the idea that, you know, sometimes the player character, through what we might call their own moral compass or whatever, will refuse to respond to your commands.
But all right, I want to note that we have about 5 minutes left for this panel. I'm on this panel, but I'm usually the one who notes this, because I run panels, so I just want to say
we're just going to talk about Metal Gear, so.
Okay, yeah, that's all okay. Because you and James are actually on the next panel as well, right?
Yeah, yes. We need to get Robbie Dude in here, but yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Absolutely. So. I mean, like, we probably don't have to end it. I mean, like we'll keep going for the next minute, and then what I'll do is we'll see if we can get Robbie. I think he's actually in there in the server. So we'll get him on, and then I'll just introduce the next panel, and then I'll leave. So that's totally fine.
Okay. Cool. And James, you were about to say something before Zelani reminded us. Yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, the only thing that I was going to mention was that, you know, like the firearm violence seems to be less emphasized. It seems to be more emphasized as a stark, dry affair in The Last of Us, whereas the up close personal violence is emphasized. It's got more juice to it. It's a much meatier experience. And so, if I were
if I were you going finish to look, your thought, and I'll take mine.
Okay, and I'm this is real short. I'm almost done. So, like, if you were going to look at a structural analysis of the violence of the game, I mean, I would. That's the limitations placed on firearm violence and the lushness given to up close and personal violence. That would be an approach, the critical approach that I would take to the analyzing. That particular part of the game. So that's my thought. Please go on.
I think we can close this panel on this thought, which is that it's not really a thought about critical approaches or anything, but it's just I think the gun violence in The Last of Us really exists kind of as a method of demonstrating some of the survival aspects of the gameplay, because throughout the game you are always maintaining very low ammo counts, and so the shooting in the game isn't even necessarily about shooting the other person. It's about reminding you that you only have 5 bullets. Does that make sense?
That's a really good point, yeah.
You know, so it's just like, I only have this many health kits. I only have this many revolver bullets. I only have this much flamethrower fuel. Also, of course, it's a video game, so there's a flamethrower. But
yeah, I didn't even know there's a flamethrower. Yeah, what's it called?
Yeah, there's a flamethrower.
Yeah. What's it called? For a last thought, I do want to actually note a last thought, because if I'm going to note a particular thing, I know we went to a lot of places this panel. One thing I do want to note as a particular thing that I think is worth taking away is this idea that I can be, when I approach a game, I can be particularly very rigid about it. I can take a particular structural approach, if I'm correct, and I can sit there and say, okay, well here are the sort of, like, I'm going to label and name these operating things that I see in the system of this game, and I'm going to note how they interact with each other and what goes on. Or I can do something, or I can go the other route, which is a route of a different kind of observations and description, which seems to describe this weird, you know, this weird annoying idea of experience, particularly, which, I mean, when I feel like I probably leaned on when I've written pieces on particular thing, which is I don't feel like I'm sitting there naming things and asking about how these things interact with each other. Rather, I'm going through this sort of a linear process of, okay, well, now I'm walking down the room. I feel like, what does it feel like to walk down this room? What do I see while I walk down the room? And then when I get to the other thing, okay, what goes on here and then that? And then I try to make something out of it. So I think the idea between those two things is something worth sort of going over and thinking about. Particularly, I feel like every panel that we've had today could go on longer than an hour. So I feel bad having to cut everything off, but
we lined up a bunch of smash hits 4 in a row.
Yeah, so I mean, because I've been listening to other ones too, and I've been really enjoying them. So definitely. But I'm gonna have to. I mean, thank you all for talking for this panel, but you're both gonna stay on, and I'm gonna see if I can get I'm gonna get off for the MGS4 panel, which is happening next. If I'm correct, let me check.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So
this is my cue to jump in here, everybody. We are gonna go straight into the panel on Metal Gear Solid 4.
Yep.
So thank you for giving us such a good transition point here. And I will invite in our next panelist, Robbie Dude. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks for joining us, Solani.
Yeah, really, no problem. I really enjoyed hearing your take on these things.
It was super, super cool to talk to you, James. I'm gonna head out, or I'm probably just gonna go quiet, and then I'll be coming back later to move to the other panel. But thanks everyone for listening to what I had to say.
Yes, thank you everybody. All right, I will get us set up here for
thank you everyone.
Metal Gear.